Okay, so this is a joint work with Steven Schockart and Victor Gutierrez Basulto that we did at Cardiff University. And well, I think we all can agree that ontologies are time are a well-established knowledge representation paradigm. However, they are time-consuming to encode manually, and they are also difficult to learn from data, as we have seen. So, indeed, there are several data-driven approaches to complete automatically ontologies. And well, some of these approaches use vector representations of knowledge, such as word embeddings and knowledge graph embeddings that exploit data from Wikidata, Freebase, and BabelNet. And usually they are good to encode information about the similarity between different concepts. But they don't do very well on encoding or learning other dependencies, such as subsumption or existential restriction, unlike some ontology languages or some ontology formalisms, such as description logics, for instance. So then there is, of course, a lot of work on combining these two abilities. So combine deductive and inductive reasoning. And this goes in both ways. So there is work exploiting symbolic knowledge representation approaches for learning higher quality vector space representations. And in the other direction, there is work using vector representations to infer missing knowledge. But these approaches rely mostly on heuristics, and their focus is on empirical performance rather than on what is the principle, the underlying principle behind it. So what we do in our paper is, well, we try to take a more principled approach by defining inference mechanisms that have clear model theoretic semantics. And the inference that we are interested in is plausible, inferring plausible concept inclusions. So these are inclusions which are not necessarily entailed by an ontology, but they are rather likely to hold given that we have some knowledge obtained from vector representations of the data and the knowledge that we already have from the ontology. So by formalizing this kind of inductive reasoning in description logics, we believe that you can have an integration between deductive and inductive inferences. And of course, one interesting question in this setting is, well, how costly is this computationally? So we study computational complexity bounds for a particular ontology language, namely the EL description logics, and we provide some boundaries for this. So what is the reasoning that we consider? So the inductive reasoning that we consider is interpolation, so-called interpolation, which is a common sense reasoning mechanism. And one key notion for interpolation is that of conceptual betweeners. So we say that a concept C is conceptually between A and B if C has all the natural properties of A and B. Now we need to understand here properties as something that objects can have in common. And it has been shown that natural properties are well suited for learning. So they function well for inductive reasoning. And well, natural properties might be seen as properties that we can use to group a set of objects, or rather that they in a sense correspond to our way of thinking. So they can be learned and observed in objects, and we actually use them to describe objects in natural language. So in the way that we can give them names. And as it happens, they correspond to convex regions in a suitable vector space. So we can to see how interpolation works, let's consider an example. So let's say that we are completing knowledge or taking knowledge about animals, and we have concepts such as giraffes and rabbits, and they have natural property in common, that is being herbivore. And we also somehow get the knowledge that zebras are conceptually between giraffes and rabbits, so they have the same natural properties that these both share. So we can actually then complete our knowledge representation by putting a concept that is zebra that is conceptually between giraffes and rabbits. So this is the way that interpolation works. Now, how do we formalize this in description logic? So the way that we do it in our paper is, well, we take our syntax of EL and we have a way to talk about natural concepts. And natural concepts are either concept names that belong to a distinguished set of names or natural concept names that we may see as natural properties that we talked before, or they could also be conjunctions or concepts that are in between natural concepts. Now, in our setting, we are also assuming that knowledge about conceptual betweenness can be obtained from vector representations. And indeed, there's work in this direction. Right, so if we take our example from the previous slide, so in this formalization, we will have that herbivore is a natural concept name, and we have the knowledge that rabbits and giraffes are herbivores as concept inclusions, and the knowledge that zebras are conceptually in between rabbits and giraffes by this constructor here. And what we want to infer, what we will be able to infer, is that zebras are herbivores by using interpolation. And actually, what we do in our paper is to consider a slightly more general pattern of induction or of reasoning, where we consider conjunctions of concepts. So if we have the two conjunctions share a natural property or are sub-concepts of a natural concept B, then we can infer that A and the concept that is in between C and D has also that property or is also a sub-concept of B. Right. So now if we want to formalize the semantics of this logic, well, there are two questions that are relevant here. So how are we going to distinguish concepts as natural, and how are we going to interpret conceptual betweenness? And what we propose in our paper is two semantics. So we have a feature-enriched interpretations. We have the spirit of formal concept analysis, and we also have geometric interpretations, which are more related to conceptual spaces. So let me give you an overview of how these semantics look like. So for feature-enriched semantics, so we enrich interpretations. So we take your classical DL interpretation and a finite set of features. And basically what we do is, for each element in the domain, we get a set of features. And this allows us to assign also a set of features to concept. And then we say that a concept C is natural if it's completely characterized by its sets of features. So what does it mean? Well, importantly, it means that if we have an element of the domain that contains the set of features of C, well, then this this element has to be an instance of the concept. And for in between us, we have that the concept that is between A and B is that one that is characterized by the intersection of features of A and B. And because it's characterized by a set of features, well, then it is a natural concept, as we describe in the syntax and as we might expect. On the other hand, we have our geometric semantics, where simply we have that concepts are interpreted as regions from a vector space, and natural concepts are now interpreted as convex regions in that space. Whereas the concept that is between A and B is just the convex hull of the union of the regions interpreting A and B. So if we go back to our example, we have that natural concepts such as giraffes, zebras, rabbits, and herbivores are interpreted as convex regions, and the concept that is or is between giraffes and rabbits is this convex hull that has a union of giraffes and rabbits. All right, so now we have, what was the cost of this? So we studied the computational complexity of subsumption in EL, which is the most important or the most basic reasoning task in EL. And it turns out that subsumption under the feature semantics is going to be complete. And for the case of geometric semantics, it turns out to be a space hard. So there are different semantics, so the complexity cost might differ. And one interesting difference of these semantics is the interaction between concept betweenness and concept conjunction. This is important because in order to have sound interpolation, as we described in our rule at the beginning, this property is somewhat crucial, so that we have distributivity of conjunction over betweenness, so basically that this subsumption holds. And in the case of feature-based semantics, well, we get this almost for free. In the way that we define the semantics, which is rather restrictive, we get that this property holds. And this restriction, or part of this restriction, is that there is a domain element for every proper subset of features. Now, what the cost of this is that we might have some anomalies in the model or in the interpretations. So, for instance, we might have elements that are both a zebra and a rabbit, and or zebra and a giraffe. And well, this is of course against the intuition that these concepts are usually or are naturally disjoint. However, for reasoning in EL, this doesn't play a role because EL cannot express disjointness. So there is no problem there. However, this indicates that this semantics is not suitable for logics that can express disjointness, which on the other hand, geometric semantics can. It's more general. The problem there is that this property doesn't hold in general. And to see this, well, we can just simply see an example. So if we consider these regions there and take the region that corresponds to this concept here, so we have that this portion here, whereas the region that corresponds to this part is, well, this other region, and they're indeed not the same. Well, this is not subsumed in the other. So what we do to ensure that we have sound interpolation in this semantics is, well, we provide sufficient conditions for interpolation to hold. And this has to do with the notion of non-interference, so that conjunction and in-betweenness do not interact. And we characterize this semantically. But we also need, have a syntax for this, right? And we, again, we assume that this can be, this information can be obtained from vector representations. And we expand then our inference by taking whenever we have that A does not interact or interfere with D and C, and we write it like that, and we have that these conjunctions have a shared natural property in common, then we can do our inference as before. And well, this is pretty much what can I tell you about our paper today. And then I can just thank you for your attention and your time. And if you have questions, please ask away. Thank you very much.